Good morning, Rayfield. We are going to continue our conversation about voting by mail and how important it is for us to receive our ballot and to vote on time. So we talked last week about filling out our ballots, about registering, about where to vote, and all of those details about how to take care of the ballot and make sure we get it. So this week, we're going to talk about checking our voting status, where to vote on election day, but we won't need to know that because we're voting by mail. We're going to talk about sample ballots. We're going to talk about the upcoming elections. We're going to talk about, very importantly, receiving a ballot by mail. We're going to review and update our registration information for voting. We're going to check the status of our ballot once we voted. And we're going to review our voting activity. So this week is a very important week because we're going to be requesting our ballots to make sure that we are registered to vote. Now, there are some important deadlines. Let's see if we can find out what those deadlines are. I believe that a few days, 29 days to be exact, before a election, you must already be registered to vote. Okay? It is very important that you are registered to vote on time, because if you're not registered to vote on time, you won't be allowed to vote. Okay, so let me see if I can see some other important information here. I'm searching the web while I'm talking to you. So yeah, even if you speak English or Spanish, I see here where you can request your ballot in your native language, however you want your ballot to be presented to you. That's how you can request it. So you can also vote online right from your living room. Boy, isn't that exciting. You don't even have to leave the comfort of your home to vote. There are several ways of voting, as we stated last week. In person, of course, online, or receive your ballot at home. Okay, so as I stated, this week we're going to be talking about receiving our ballot, registering to vote online. So let's get ready, Rayfield. It's an exciting time. We need to participate in voting. We need to be updated on what our candidates believe, and you're going to do that on your own. But for school purposes, we are going to show you how to vote by mail, how to register to vote, and all of the details that come along with voting. So, good morning, Rayfield. Let's get ready to vote. Okay, guys, it's day 5. We've been through a whole week of series of activities and lessons on how to vote. We are exercising our right to vote at Rayfield. We are determining in our minds, our political party and who we will vote for. However, our series of lessons don't focus on candidates. It simply focuses on the process, the life skill of how to vote and be a viable member of the community. So we've been through 5 lessons this week. We've learned so much about the voting process. We're very excited. And I know that you're excited and that you're ready to vote. We're going to continue throughout the next couple of weeks with more information on voting. However, the last 5 days have taken us through all of the details that we need to know on how to vote. We live in Broward County, Florida, and we have followed the procedures and the guidelines that have been outlined for us by the supervisor of elections in Broward County. This information will help us be able to vote and do so in a manner in which our vote will be counted. I want you to be confident. I want you to understand the process. I want you to know that it is your right to vote. This is an important life skill, and if you are questioned or if you want to share with someone how you may help them vote, you will now have the information to do so. You can go back and look at these videos at any time if you have questions, and it will help refresh your memory on how to vote. These types of things are extremely important as we walk through life together as friends of Rayfield. Friends of Rayfield are sharing with you the important information that you need in your life. As you know, Rayfield loves you. We are family is our motto and our theme. And we want you to know that during this month and during this time, as we prepare for the elections, not only in the United States and in our city and states, but also at our school, we also choose those offices in each class for our students so that we have people governing the class that are professional, that are doing so in a nice manner to represent everyone in the class. We want you to understand what it means to be a political person and the integrity and the dignity that it takes for folks to trust in you. We know that you're smart and you're excited and you're educated. It is our job to educate you and inform you on how to vote. Remember, you have the right to vote. Rayfield loves you. Get excited, Rayfield. We're getting ready to vote. Thank you. It's been an exciting series of lessons, and we will continue more lessons on how to vote. Get excited, Rayfield. Let's move forward. Have a great day. This is day 5 on how to vote.
Hi, my name is Makaya, and today we'll be talking about the power of habits. We're going to start off by talking about good habits. So, introduction. Creatures of habits. Barack Obama organized every aspect of his day as president so that routine decisions took as little as cognitive energy as possible, allowing him to focus on the high-stakes decisions. "You'll see I only wear gray or blue suits," Obama told Vanity Fair in 2012. "I'm trying to pare down decisions I don't want to make about what I'm eating or wearing because I have too many other decisions to make." He referred to research that shows that the simple act of making a decision degrades one's ability to make further decisions and noted that's why shopping can be exhausting. The president's advice. Remove from your life the day-to-day problems that consume most people for meaningful parts of their day. You need to focus your decision-making energy. You need to routinize yourself. You can't be going through the day distracted by trivia. Reflections on the role of habits in our intellectual lives predates Obama by a couple of millennia and more. Aristotle once said, "Some thinkers hold that it is by nature that people become good, others that it is by habit, and others that it is by instruction." In his view, habits reveal and define a person's character. When Alexander Hamilton co-authored the Federalist Papers, he mused on how to influence citizens to obey the federal laws of a republic in its infancy. He stated that man is very much a creature of habit. Hamilton theorized that if federal law permeated matters at the state level, it would become a part of everyday life. The more it circulates through those channels and currents in which the passions of mankind naturally flow, the less it will require the aid of violent and perilous expedients of compulsion. In 1887, the psychologist and philosopher William James wrote about the same tenets that Obama utilizes in Habit, a brief treatise on how our behavioral patterns shape who we are. According to James, habits shape what we often refer to as character and personality. When we look at living creatures from an outward point of view, one of the first things that strike us is that they are bundles of habits, wrote James. In wild animals, the usual round of daily behavior seems a necessity implanted at birth. In animals domesticated, and especially in man, it seems to a great extent to be the result of education. The habits to which there is an innate tendency are called instincts. Some of those, due to education, would by most persons be called acts of reason. It thus appears that habit covers a very large part of life. James begins his treatise with a scientific and a psychological account of the brain and neurobiology, touching on the notion of neuroplasticity a century before it became a hallmark of modern neuroscience. And he presents this definition. Plasticity, in the wild sense of the word, means the possession of a structure weak enough to yield to an influence, but strong enough not to yield all at once. Modern neuroscience defines neuroplasticity as the ability of neural networks in the brain to change through growth and reorganization throughout an individual's life. These types of changes include systematic adjustments such as cortical remapping, which affects our sensory and motor systems, circuit and network changes that result from learning a new skill, psychological stress and environmental stimuli are all examples of neuroplasticity at work. Neuroscientists once thought that plasticity only manifested during childhood, which makes James's work so groundbreaking. But research in the second half of the 20th century found that although the developing brain is more amenable to change than the adult brain, there are still many aspects of the adult brain that are plastic throughout one's life. James underscores the importance of building habits early through education. We must make automatic and habitual as early as possible as many useful actions as we can and guard against the growing into ways that are likely to be disadvantageous to us, as we should guard against the plague. The more of the details of our daily life we can hand over to the effortless custody of automatism, the more our higher powers of mind will be set free for their own proper work, wrote James. There is no more miserable human being than one in whom nothing is habitual, but indecision, and for whom the lighting of every cigar, the drinking of every cup, the time of rising and going to bed every day, and the beginning of every bit of work are subjects of express volitional deliberation. Modern-day researchers would agree with James that just because the adult brain can change and shift doesn't mean that it's easy to do so. Old behaviors can be hard to shift and new behaviors take time to develop, but that does not mean that the endeavor is out of reach. In Good Habits, Bad Habits, the social psychologist Wendy Wood builds the idea of automating one's habits, partly as a way to protect and exert control over our subconscious selves. Scientists have only recently begun to unravel the multifaceted nature of ourselves and to identify our resulting biases and preferences. With this understanding, we can never fully undo these influences, but we can account for them when we act. Our own behavior springs from some of the most mysterious, deeply hidden, and until recently, unrecognized sources of irrationality. Wood writes, "We need to stop overestimating our rational selves and instead come to understand that we are made up of deeper parts too. We can think of these other parts as whole other selves just waiting to be recognized and giving the command to get to work." Wood explains that humans have the tendency to overestimate the decision-making aspects of habits, and that instead we ought to channel the brain's plasticity to make changes that become automatic. A brain scan of someone learning a task shows activity in the prefrontal cortex and the hippocampus networks associated with decision-making. But when a learned task is repeated, the brain activity on the scan in the areas of the putamen and the basal ganglia is what Wood refers to as the rudimentary machinery of our minds. That is where a habit is formed. To convince the brain to update its models of the world and one's reactions to that world requires repetition. Your morning commute is a culmination of habits formed throughout constant repetition. When you get into a car, you don't need a second thought about buckling the seatbelt. Your hand places the key in the ignition without your deciding to do so. Checking your blind spots is a survival mechanism that is second nature. If you want to rewire your brain to create the habit of walking at 6 a.m. to meditate, there is no way around your having to repeat the process over and over until you do it without having to exert the willpower to compel yourself. Not only does automating this feel-good action make sure that you actually do it each day, but the habit frees up your energy to concentrate on other things that require conscious attention, such as goal setting for the day ahead. Habits lead to a better life. It's not just about productivity, writes Wood. You hear people often complaining that they overthink things. We all do sometimes. It can lead to anxiety and become a real challenge to getting anything done. She notes that that a focus on mindfulness has cropped up in recent years to oppose the overthinking menace. Wood explains that the idea to be thoughtfully aware without losing yourself in your head. To be mindful, you are focused on the here and now and not worry about the upcoming challenges of ruminating on past failures or mistakes. Habits are perhaps the most natural and effective way humans have to achieve this non-evaluative state of mind, writes Wood. A habitual mind is a benignly thoughtless mind. It is a mind that sorts tasks into their proper places. It delegates, it sits at the intersection and assigns routes. It is not obsessed with figuring out when you fall asleep, as you might have tried to do so as a child. Instead, it just responds to the sleep cues in your context as you drift off, usually. Chapter 1. Good Habits. The right daily rituals can improve our health, ease our minds, and give our families a shared sense of belonging. Small changes, big results. From a morning plank to a garden meditation, little moves can bring peace, not to mention a better grasp of remembering where you put those darn sunglasses. Every night after dinner, Audrey Slatter has a little ritual. She kicks her husband and teen daughter out of the kitchen and listens to the podcast while she cleans up. Here's the thing, Pod Save America and The Axe Files are some of my favorites, says Slater, who lives in Madison, Connecticut, and is a wardrobe stylist at Live with Kelly and Ryan. It's amazing. I now actually look forward to doing the dishes. I also do a little something that has made a world of a difference in my day. It's nothing profound or spiritual, but it's plenty satisfying. During the 4 dead minutes while I wait for my oatmeal to cook, I quickly unload the dishwasher. Boom, done. One task eliminated. Before I've even had breakfast. As it turns out, microsteps can play an oversized role in keeping us calm, healthy, productive, and happy. Small habits are within our control and can make a huge difference in our well-being, says Gretchen Rubin, the host of podcast Happier with Gretchen Rubin and the author of Better Than Before. What I learned about making breakfast the everyday habits of our life. Take sleep, she says. If you go from getting 5 hours of sleep at night to 7 hours, you might see a dramatic improvement in how you feel. Adding a small positive habit is a particularly doable way to boost your sense of fulfillment. A large portion of our happiness is under our control, says Sanja Libermisker, PhD, a professor of psychology at the University of California, Riverside. While both small habits, like keeping a gratitude journal, and big changes, like getting out of a bad relationship, will increase feelings of joy, the little moves have one definite advantage. They're more in reach. Often, the big things, changing jobs, moving cities, having a baby, are not very controllable or easy to accomplish. Libermirsker points out, but the small things you can start working on tomorrow. For many people, the best microsteps are one of that are fast and transform dreary tasks or dead time into moments of escape or accomplishment. Try one or more of these 8 ideas to see if it proves to be a game changer in your daily life. Hold one plank. I'm not the only one making lemonade out of dead time. Kathy Cavender, an editor in Norwalk, Connecticut, noticed that she had boring, wasted minutes every morning while she waited for her hair to air dry enough to finish it with a blow dryer. So she got on the floor and held a plank. I started doing a 1-minute plank and 30-second side-to-side planks on each side. At the beginning, I could hardly hold a side plank at all, which was always embarrassing in yoga class, she says. Her mini routine has already made a difference. She is happy to report I'm up to 1 minute 50 seconds on holding my plank. Slipping strength training into your day ensures that you won't neglect this key health move. Try a plank hold challenge or do as many push-ups as you can while waiting for, say, your partner to get out of the shower or your oven to preheat. Or keep 5-pound hand weights in a basket by the sofa and do 3 sets of 10 biceps and tricep curls every night while making your way through Killing Eve or catching up with CNN. Short cardio sessions also get the job done. If you mix in bursts of high-intensity movement, a study in the journal PLOS-1 found that this fast and furious approach was just as effective for cardiorespiratory fitness as much as longer durations of moderate exercise. Over a 12-week period, the researchers compared 2 groups of sedentary adults. One group did 10-minute workouts, including 1 minute of high-intensity exercise, 3 days a week, and the other group did 50 minutes of moderate exercise 3 times a week. The study found that the people doing the quickie sessions got the same cardio bang for the buck as the people doing longer workouts. Replace mindless scrolling with 3 minutes of Zen. So we often turn to our devices to fill waiting time, whether we're stuck in line at Starbucks or on hold with Visa. Think of these few minutes as found bonus time for you, recommends Alexis Hazelbergen, a time management and productivity coach in San Francisco. Use that time to do a few minutes of deep breathing. You can also use a meditation app such as Calm or Headspace. These options can feel so much better than the mindless scroll on social media, she says. Note the small slices of joy. You love your first cup of coffee every morning, but do you take a second to notice how much you love it? Shade Men Tang, the author of Joy on Demand, wants us to register the fleeting moments of pleasure already in our day. Tan is a former Google executive who created a mindfulness program to help supremely stressed out Silicon Valley staffers feel calmer, and then went on to write books and give a TED Talk. By mentally logging the small good stuff, we train our brains to see these slices of joy already in our life, a concept central to the Buddhism-inspired mindfulness movement. There is even Western science behind this idea. The hallmark of being happy, of being a happy person, is to experience daily bursts of positive emotion. So anything you can do to increase the frequency of these boosts will contribute to overall happiness, says Lumber Nusky, who has spent decades conducting research on positive psychology. Research suggests that trying to savor little things each day, the melody of a song, the smell of a flower in your garden, the taste of your morning coffee, can improve your mood and well-being. There are happy little moments everywhere. That refreshing first sip of iced tea on a hot day, the pleasure when you first step outside and the sun hits your skin, the way your body relaxes when your partner gives you a hug, or your pup hops on your lap. Rather than letting these pleasant happenings pass unnoticed, Tan wants us to tell ourselves, I'm feeling joy now. Why bother? We have a bias built into our brain that makes us hone into what is wrong in our environment. Experts say this radar has helped humans survive. Our brains are wired to look for threats in order to stay one step ahead. The trouble is that we end up feeling like there is danger everywhere. By forcing ourselves to catch and catalog the good, we are actually training our brains to notice it automatically. Get an awe fix. It's hard to believe, but in just a few minutes a day, you can treat yourself to awe, a complex emotion that helps you feel something bigger than yourself. According to research by Dacher Kettler at the University of California, Berkeley, and other social scientists, regularly experiencing awe can improve our mood and make us feel more connected. And while you may think you need to visit the Grand Canyon or stand in front of Michelangelo's David to get that sense of wow, everyday things have the power to induce goosebumps. Sign up at poets.org to have a poem delivered to your inbox every day. Take a work break for 5 minutes each day to gaze at one great work, like Monet, Blue Water Lilies, and the Musée d'Orsay in Paris. Through Google Arts and Culture, if nature is what moves you most, follow the Smithsonian Zoo or Cincinnati Zoo on Instagram to feel overcome by the range of majestic and adorable animals. Or soak in the wonder of nature right in your neighborhood or backyard. A chipmunk may not be panda cute, but stopping to watch him scurry around can feel pretty amazing anyway. Be micro-organized. Could there be a more universal goal than to be more organized? It's a great one to attack the micro level. Because really, who wants to spend a weekend sorting all your stuff? The 1 minute workaround, don't put it down, put it away, says Lisa Dooley, an organizing coach in Cohasset, Massachusetts, and the author of More Space, More Time, More Joy. Staying organized is really about creating little daily habits that then have a positive effect on health and happiness. When you use anything, the phone charger, screwdriver, car insurance policy folder, put it back in its proper home so you can find it when you need it next time. This one step can save you time, stress, and money, she says. What about keeping track of your keys, wallet, sunglasses, those essentials you can't go out without? Organizer Sarah Grant, founder of B.net Studio in Toronto, swears by setting up a designated place close to the door. Think open baskets, hooks, a tray, or cubbies. We have one basket for adults and one for kids, and hooks for each, says Grant, who is a mom of two boys. That way, it's easy to stash your essential items as soon as you step in the door, and keep them handy for when you need to step out again. Add a food ritual. Let's say you want to drink more water every day. It's a simple habit, but it can feel tough to put into action. But science suggests that if you elevate the glass of water in your mind by creating a ritual around it, the action will feel like something to savor and value more. Research published a psychological science tested whether rituals around food, I like swirling wine in a glass before drinking it, stirring your tea and clinking the spoon on the side makes us savor food more. The researchers devised a series of experiments. In one study, half the people were told to unwrap chocolate bars a certain way before eating, while the other half were told to relax for a short time and then eat them any which way. The group with the ritual savored the bar more and said they would pay more for it. You're probably thinking, yeah, that's chocolate. Try that with a carrot. Well, the scientists did, and the results were the same. So back to that goal of drinking more water. By creating a procedure around filling your water bottle or glass, you'll help reinforce the habit. Maybe you always use the same pitcher and glass. It may sound hokey, but it can help you cement the habit. Rework your vocabulary. Studies show that when dieters say, I don't, rather than I can't, they feel less deprived. Why? Because it changes the situation from a feeling of deprivation to one of choice. Along these same lines, regularly using the phrase, I choose or I get to, helps shift us into a happier state, says life coach Patricia Love. When you say, I choose to work out or I get to go to work, it gives you an uplifting feeling of gratitude, Love says. It takes your mind to, I'm healthy, I have the means to go to gym, I have a beautiful neighborhood to run or bike through. Adding the right words are simple changes anyone can do to create big changes in their life, she adds. Have a pre-bed snooze button. We all want to get more sleep, but it's surprisingly tough to do. One trick, Ruben says, is to use the strategy of convenience. Often, we put off going to bed because we don't have the energy for all that prep work. Removing contact lenses, washing your face, changing into pajamas. Try doing this. Do your pre-sleep ritual 1 hour before bedtime. Then you're like, oh, it's 10:30. I can just go to bed right now. I don't have to go through a long list of tasks. You may want to try what Ruben calls the strategy of safeguards, which means troubleshooting for what you expect could go wrong. For instance, maybe you get so immersed in watching TV that you lose track of time. Solution, set an alarm. Just like that, you have an alarm to wake up, set an alarm for, say, 10:15, it goes off, then you hit the snooze alarm, and just like you do in the morning, and then it goes off again, and then you're like, okay, it's 10:30 now. Am I in bed? Keep in mind that you need to do more than really want a good night's sleep. You have to take these kinds of small steps to achieve it. With habits, people make the mistake of thinking that if they just whip themselves into frenzy of desire, then their actions will follow. But that's not the case, Ruben says. the fun way to make fitness stick. Want to shape up? Turning exercise into a game can get you into the routine for life. In our quest to get fit, we have come to accept that in order to find success, we must be miserable. We must endure punishing workouts, choose gyms that promise no pain, no gain, and sign up for hot yoga and spinning that leaves us feeling, well, hot. We buy fitness tanks emblazoned with mantras like, it's my workout, I can cry if I want to. But what if we're doing fitness all wrong? There's growing evidence that to get into a healthy exercise groove, we might want to make our workouts a little more fun. One study of people who were previously inactive and started an exercise routine found that those who enjoyed their activity were more likely to stick with it. Anything that is good for you, a should, and then is tweaked to make it fun. A want becomes a must, says motivational expert Michael Strahilovitz, a professor of behavioral economics at the University of Wollongong in Australia. Making exercise fun, transform it from being a chore you can skip to a healthy addiction you must do. Think about it. When was the last time you saw a bunch of kindergartners on a playground groaning, ugh, I have to keep playing on these monkey bars? They don't, because who wants fun to end? Whether you enlist a buddy to accompany you to workout classes, play Dance Dance Revolution in front of your TV, or join the plank challenge at the local yoga studio, you'll be stimulating the reward center of your brain and increasing the odds you'll want more. And more is what we all clearly need. The Department of Health and Human Services recommends that adults get 150 minutes of moderate or 75 minutes of vigorous exercise each week. The following are some strategies to transform an exercise habit into something you enjoy. The buddy system. Fitness experts report that one of the best ways to cement an exercise habit, which takes about 6 weeks, according to Canadian research, is to do it with a friend. That makes sense. Friends keep us accountable. We don't want to let someone down, so we're less likely to blow off that workout. Friends also relieve the boredom factor. You can laugh about the crazy woman in front of you at SoulCycle or the man you saw running in his dress shoes. And having someone by our side can ease our everyone in the gym is looking at me anxiety. Research shows that we release more endorphins when we work out with others, and endorphins are force multipliers for fun. Another appeal of buddy workouts, they feel like a treat. It's time with a person we like, after all. A small vacation from daily routines, says health and wellness coach Carol Phillips, author of 52 Simple Ways to Health and founder of Health Design, a New Hampshire-based company that organizes wellness plans for companies. We're social creatures, she says. When we plan to exercise with other people, we tend to look forward to it, feel an obligation to show up and view it as a time off from our working lives. Hikes, walks, and runs go that much faster when you're LOLing about last night's episode of your favorite reality show instead of OMGing about how you still have half a mile to go. Here's a tip to up your game even further. Consider buddying up with a friend who is in better shape than you are. Friends influence our behavior in all areas of life. And much like your friend who was always persuading you to cut class in middle school, your workout partner can be a determinant if she likes to blow off the gym for rich coffee drinks and muffins. But as with your other friend who was forever encouraging you to join all-night group study sessions, you can get a lot from following the lead of someone who is seriously committed to physical fitness. In fact, a 2016 study published in the journal Obesity found that the greater the number of fit friends who entered an obese person's world, the more weight that person tended to lose. What makes this kind of collaborative fitness regimen easier is that there are so many ways to friend up for physical fitness. Train for a 5K together, set a weekly date to go to spin class, meet for an after-dinner speed walk, play tennis or squash. That may seem very elitist or madmanish, but hitting some balls around might be just the break you need from your solitary slog on the Stairmaster. And it can be emotionally satisfying to smash something after a long day of dealing with annoyances. If you don't have a sporty buddy in your life, you're not doomed. You can join a team and make new friends, especially with a little online help. Squads, an app invented by Johns Hopkins student, plugs you into open gyms and pickup games nearby. It also lets you set up your own games and put out a call for players from one or more basketballers for a 5-on-5 to a partner for a doubles tennis match. An online community, Zog Sports, lets people in 7 cities get in on local pickup games of soccer, basketball, and other sports. You compete, you win. Turns out, being a sore loser can be a good thing. Adding the element of competition can get you more hooked on working out, according to a University of Pennsylvania study published in Preventative Medicine Reports. Researchers created a fitness initiative and sorted students into 4 groups with different interpersonal dynamics. 2 with a competitive element, 1 with a support element, and 1 control. They were all encouraged to attend workout classes. At the end of 11 weeks, the 2 groups with a competitive element, 1 group faced off in teams, and the other individually had 90% higher attendance rates than the control group. And the friendly support group, social comparison, the researchers concluded, can be surprisingly effective for motivating desirable behaviors. Jennifer Safre, owner of Emeralds Yoga in Pembroke, Massachusetts, has seen this effect in action at her studio. "We gamify our practice with monthly challenges," she says. The contests range from a plank a day challenge to attendance competitions. In all of them, participants are facing off against themselves, working to beat their last performance, so everyone who completes the challenge wins a prize. There are those who say this cheapens yoga, Safri says, but I think it's short-sighted. The way she sees it, her game board is a win-win. The students, all adults, love putting up stickers and checking their progress. They get the benefit of more practice, and I get the benefit of keeping my business healthy. Well, that's all for the video. Hope you enjoyed it. Bye!
Good day, Rayfield family. Here are your weather forecasts for this week. Wednesday, partly cloudiness early with scattered showers and thunderstorms during the afternoon. High 88, winds east-northeast at 15 to 25 miles per hour, chance of rain 50%. Thursday, partly to mostly cloudy skies with scattered thunderstorms in the morning. High 88, winds east at 10 to 20 miles per hour, chance of rain 50%. Friday, scattered thunderstorms in the morning with mostly cloudy skies late. High 87. Winds east-southeast at 10 to 20 miles per hour. Chance of rain 50%. Saturday, mainly cloudy. A stray shower or thunderstorms is possible. High 88. Winds east-southeast at 10 to 20 miles per hour. Sunday, widely scattered showers and thunderstorms early. Clouds lingering later. High 88. Winds east-southeast at 10 to 15 miles per hour. Chance of rain 40%. Monday, Sun and clouds mixed with a slight chance of thunderstorms during the afternoon. High 87. Winds east-southeast at 10 to 15 miles per hour. Chance of rain 30%. Tuesday. Partly cloudy skies. A stray shower or thunderstorm is possible. High 87. Winds east-southeast at 5 to 10 miles per hour. Wednesday. Sunshine along with some cloudy intervals. High 88. Winds east-southeast at 10 to 15 miles per hour. Thursday. Sunshine and clouds mixed. High 88. Winds east-southeast at 10 to 15 miles per hour. Friday. Sunshine and clouds mixed. High 87. Winds east-southeast at 10 to 15 miles per hour. These are your weather forecasts for this week. Keep your umbrella handy just in case we have rain in the forecast. Make sure that you keep updated with the latest weather forecast, as it will change from time to time by either watching from your television or listening to your radio or from any devices that carries their weather app. Thank you for tuning in, and may you have a productive week.
Good morning, Rayfield. This month's theme is Why Be Average When You Can Be Awesome in August at Rayfield. This month's birthstone is peridot. This month's flower is gladiolus. This month we are celebrating back to school. Our back to school day is August 28th, 2019. Now we're going to stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, we're so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the
our reading. reading will be coming from the book of Psalms 121. That is Psalms 121. And the Bible reads, I will lift up my eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Thus is the reading of God's word coming from Psalms 121. May God bless the hearers and the doers of his word. Amen.
Tell him thank you, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Oh. Come on. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Anybody else's testimony about besides myself? Tell them you've been so. I see you, Betty Jackson. Been so good. Good to see you, girl. You've been so good. You've been so. Been so good. Hallelujah.
I like it. We get to meet new people, and I don't know what else.
I love that. What about you, Harry? What do you like about back to school?
New school year start.
Oh, okay. Good job, that's Harry. Great. Cameron, what do you like about back to school?
I love coming to school to hang out with my friends.
Okay.
I get to do morning announcements.
Okay.
I do PE. I like doing piecework. I like coming to Rayfield.
Oh, that sounds great. Chris, what do you like about back to school?
I like back to school because we do a lot of work and do schoolwork.
Good okay. job, Chris.
Chelsea, what do you like about back to school?
I like doing piecework.
No.
And what happens when you do piecework?
Make money.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, Leon. What do you like about being in Rayfield, being back in school?
I like working so hard. And maybe make money, I guess.
Okay. Nice. Let's tell everybody, welcome back to school.
Welcome back to school.
We'll sing hallelujah. Bye and bye. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, good morning, good morning. God has done it once again. He smiled upon us. He blessed us to be able to open our eyes to see a brand new day. Thank you, Lord. Thank God for one more sunny day. Good morning, prayer warriors. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. If God, if you're watching this video right now, you know that you have been blessed by the Most High God. And so if anybody asks you how you're doing today, you know how to answer. You know the response. How are you doing this morning? You just tell them, I am blessed. I am blessed. I am blessed. God has blessed us to be able to see July 16, 2021. And he's allowed us to come together again for another conversation with God. God is good, y'all, not just some of the time. God is good all the time. How are you doing this morning, Sister Pearl Thurston? Are you doing well? How you doing, Mike? Good to see you, man. Good to see you. Elaine Frazier. Linda Garland is in the building. Sister Plummer. Good to see you, Sister Hunter. Stephanie Harris is here this morning. Thank God for you. Sister McKenzie, thank God for you. Lonnie's always good to see you. Sister Carter's in the building. We so appreciate each and every one of you for joining us. Tim, good to see you. Elaine Davis, good to see you. Good to see you. Gail, Cecilia Johnson, we appreciate you so much. And Lynn Robertson, Tess Hayes is always here. Derek Cooper, Jenny Rome is in the building. I'm just giving shout outs this morning because I'm grateful for each and every one of you who take the time out to join with me and the other prayer warriors for a conversation with God. Thank you so much, Dorothy Malone, for joining with us. Joanne, thank God for you. And hopefully you guys have been having a blessed week. You know, God has blessed us to be able to see another Friday. And for many people, you know, it may be the end of the work week, but nevertheless, we thank God for each and every day that he allows us to see. Because no day that God allows us to see is guaranteed for us. We are able to see this day because of his mercy and his grace. And so we are looking forward to having a great day in the Lord, being able to use the opportunity that God has given us for his glory and for his honor. And as we get ready to close out this particular week, we're going to look at another parable. Remember, during the month of July, we are looking at the parables of Jesus from the Gospel of Luke. And so all month we're looking and reading from the Gospel of Luke and looking at the parables of Jesus to find out what God will have us to know and what God will have us to do in order to be the people that he has called us to be and be able to possess his promises. This morning we're going to Luke chapter 15. Good morning, sister, brother and sister Lampkins. Always appreciate you guys, and we're definitely praying for you. Luke chapter 15, and we're going to look at verses 1 through 7. Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. Thank God for each and every one of you. Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. Thank you, Jesse Wright. Thank you, Sister Plummer, Anessa. Thank you guys for sharing those scriptures. Definitely appreciate it. Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. And don't forget, please don't forget, you know, conversation with God is all about prayer and the power of prayer. And so we want to, if you have any prayer requests, if you want God's help and God's mercy for yourself because of something that you're dealing with, something that you're going through, or maybe it's somebody else that you know that's standing in the need of prayer, please don't hesitate to leave your prayer requests in the comment section. Because the Bible teaches us that the prayers of the righteous are powerful and effective. And so when God's people pray for you, I truly believe by faith that great things happen because God responds to the prayers of his children. So if you have any prayer requests, please don't hesitate to leave your prayer requests in the comment section. All right, Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. The Bible reads, "Then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, This man receives sinners and eateth with them. And he spake this parable unto them, saying, What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he finds it. And when he has found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repented more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repented more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. Brothers and sisters, this morning, our tag and our title for today's devotion is Lost Souls Matter. Lost souls matter. Say it with your mouth. Lost souls matters. Say it in your heart. Get it in your heart. Lost souls matter. Write it in the comment section. Lost souls matter. I think this message right here is so important for the church today because it falls in line with so much that is going on in our world today. Many of us, you know, are familiar with a statement that is commonly used today, and that's Black Lives Matter. And you've heard that said over the past few years as issues of injustice and racism come to the forefront, and we see the abuses that that Black people have experienced in this nation. And so that phrase came up a few years ago, Black Lives Matter. And people wonder, well, you know, all lives matter. So why should we say something like Black Lives Matter? And when I read this particular parable here, it gave me a different understanding of that term and helped me to understand why, even though all lives matter to God, there are certain groups, certain people that God gives special attention to. There are some people and there are some groups that deserve special attention because of the group that they're in, because of the risk, because of the danger, because of the jeopardy that they are in at this particular time. And in Luke chapter 15, Jesus gives three parables back to back that point out the fact that in the sight of God, even though God loves everybody, God gives special attention to those who are lost. Because even though all souls matter to God, guess what? Lost souls matter to God. And lost souls are those souls that in these parables we see in Luke chapter 15, Jesus is trying to help people to understand why lost souls matter, why we need to give special attention to this particular group of individuals on this earth, why God cares so much about lost souls, even though all souls matter to him. Now, this text, the context of Luke chapter 15 is so interesting because it says that he drew near unto, verse 1, then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. In other words, the publicans were the tax collectors. Those were the outcasts. People hated those people. They despised them because of their role in society. And then you had the sinners. That's a overall a category of people that were despised among the Jewish people. They were seen as the unrighteous folks, the unholy folks. But for some reason, these groups of people were drawn to Jesus. The outcasts and the sinners were drawn to Jesus. And I truly believe it's because they felt his love and his compassion. They listened to his teachings. And some way, somehow, Jesus was able to hit home with them, with his teachings and his messages. And so publicans and sinners were drawn to Jesus. As a matter of fact, not only were they drawn to him, Jesus welcomed them. Let me ask you this. Are sinners welcome in the church today? Are sinners welcomed by Christians? Do sinners, those who feel outcast, those who are rejected by the world, do they feel welcomed by the church today? I truly believe that when we look at the example of Jesus and the message that he gave, not only through his teachings, but through his example and through his life, the church, we as Christians, we got some work we need to do. Because for far too long, you know, it seemed that the church is sending the world, is sending the lost, sending sinners the message that sinners are not welcome here. If you don't believe me, look at the next verse. In Luke 15, the verse number 2, it says, and the Pharisees and sinners murmur, saying, this man, referring to Jesus, receives sinners. In other words, he welcomes sinners and eateth with them. But the religious people, the Pharisees and scribes, were constantly watching Jesus, hoping to catch him or trap him, you know, and have something negative to say about him. And so they were always watching him and always had something critical to say about his actions. You know, there are some people that are always going to be watching what you do. They'll never have anything positive to say about the good things that you're doing. They always have something negative to say. That's the thing about religious folks. There's some folks in the church that always got something negative to say, even about the good that the church is doing. And so it was with the Pharisees and the scribes. They knew what the scripture said. They knew what the law said, but they were so caught up in their own self-righteousness, they forgot about the righteousness of God. So they were always watching Jesus, always looking to trap him. And they were looking at, always had something critical to say about his actions, especially his actions that were contrary to their traditions and their cultural prejudices. You heard me? Those scribes and Pharisees had traditions and cultural prejudices. They looked down upon certain people. They despised people. They thought that they were better than certain people. And so they were always critical of Jesus' actions towards certain groups of people. Because Jesus' actions, his mercy, his love, his compassion towards people exposed the hypocrisy and the self-righteousness of the religious folks of his day. And there was perhaps no other action that the scribes and Pharisees were more upset about than Jesus' association with sinners. They got mad. They were critical of the fact that the people that religious folks looked down upon and despised, those were the same people that Jesus welcomed. Those are the same people that felt comfortable around Jesus. Ooh, wouldn't it be great if that was the attitude that the world had today when it came to the church, where lost souls matter and people feel that they are, even though they're not perfect, even though they struggle, even though they're going through challenges, they have their hurts, their habits, and their hang-up, that God still loves them, God still welcomes them, God still wants to heal them and bless them. Wouldn't that be great if that's the message and the image of the church today in the world? But the scribes and the Pharisees, the religious folks, always had a problem with how Jesus associated with sinners. They would often ask, why is he hanging around these people? And that's what they ask him. Look at him. He's welcoming these people. These people. He cares about these people. These people. Look at, does he not know who these people are? He's supposed to be holy. He's supposed to be righteous. Why is he associating with them people, the unholy, the unrighteous, the outcast? Why does he care so much? Why does he spend so much time? Why do they matter to him? All souls matter. Why does he spend so much time with those sinners right there? In Luke chapter 15, Luke gives three parables that explain how even though God loves everybody, lost souls matter to God. In other words, this group of people in the sight of God deserve extra attention. They deserve our attention. They deserve our efforts. They deserve our energy. They deserve our compassion. because lost souls matter. So in Luke chapter 15, you see Jesus give three parables that talk about God's mindset and attitude towards lost souls, those who are lost, those who are disconnected from him. He gives the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin, and then the last one, the parable of the lost son, which we often refer to as the prodigal son. And that lets you know that Jesus said, you know, if you don't get the first parable, let me give you another. If you don't get the second parable, let me give you a third one. And so that lets us know that this is something, a message that God really wants us to grasp and understand, that lost souls matter. God cares about everybody, but lost souls matter. And guess what? That's all of us. Because if you think that you are holy and you think that you are righteous, if you think that you already made it in, you probably need Jesus the most. But Jesus gives three parables. And in the lost sheep, he talks about this shepherd in verse number four, Luke 15, verse four. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, does not leave the 99, the 99 in the wilderness, and go after that which is lost until he finds it? This person, this shepherd, has 100 sheep. And when one of them is lost, he leaves the 99 and gives special effort, energy, and attention to rescuing and helping and saving that one lost sheep. Why? Because lost sheep matter. And the reason why lost sheep and lost souls matter to God is that God sees their value. That shepherd values all those sheep. When something doesn't matter to you, when you don't see the value in something, if you lose it, oh, it doesn't matter. You know, if you miss it, if it's being mistreated, oh, it doesn't matter. Because you don't see the worth of that individual. You don't see the value of that individual in the sight of God. So it's nothing if you see, you know, a black person getting beat up or abused or whatever the case may be. Oh, you know, they deserve that. You don't see the worth of that individual, but God sees the worth of that person. God sees the value of that person. That person matters to God, and that person ought to matter to you. So if you see them lost, if you see them hurting, if you see them being abused, if you see them being oppressed, you ought to be concerned about it. And so that shepherd leaves a 99 sheep behind and goes after that one sheep, until he finds it. And then not only does he find it, he said he laid it on his shoulder. That's showing care and compassion. He's rejoicing. He's happy that he was able to rescue that one lost sheep. Then he brings it back. And when he comes on, it says, verse number 6, he's called together his friends and his neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I found my sheep, which was lost. Let's celebrate. Let's celebrate this lost sheep, this lost soul that I have found. Now they're safe. But you got to recognize the value of that lost soul. And not only that, these parables teach us that that lost souls matter to God because God sees the danger that lost souls are in. You know, the Bible says that God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. When a soul is separated from God, when a sinner is separated from God, that sinner is in danger of not only the wrath of God and the judgment of God, but they're in danger of the destructive tactics of the devil. We know that the devil walking about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And men and women are in bondage to sin. And sin, the Bible says, the wages of sin is death. So sin is destructive. It will destroy you. It will separate a person from God for eternity. So God cares about that lost soul. God cares about that sinner because he sees and knows the danger that they're in. And he has a sense of urgency. You look at the next parable that Jesus gives about the lost coin. This woman, she loses a coin. And the Bible says she has 10 pieces of silver and she loses one piece and she lights a candle and sweeps the whole house and seeks diligently until she finds it. And that should be the attitude and the mindset of God's people when we think about those who are lost. We want to do all we can, go into every nook and every cranny because that the lost souls matter to God. That soul is valuable. We see the danger that that lost soul is in, the danger of being separated from God for eternity. Then not only that, God sees the dilemma that lost souls are in. You know, that sheep, that coin, that son, at some point in time, did not even know that they were lost. There are a lot of people right now, a lot of sinners, a lot of individuals who don't even realize that they're separated from God. You know, I got a good job. I got a, you know, my bills are paid. I got a nice house. I got these nice things. But the question is their soul right with God? Because Jesus said on one occasion, what is it for a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? So the dilemma that lost souls are in right now is that a lot of them don't even realize that they're lost. And the story of the lost son, the prodigal son, the Bible says at one point when he was in that pig pen, he came to himself. When he came to himself, when he realized that he was living beneath his privilege and that he needed to get back to his father, a lot of people don't get to that point. And so it's up to us, those of us who God has chosen to be in this world and not of this world, it's up to us to go back and take that message to them, help them to understand the dilemma that they're in right now, so that they too can come to themselves and say, you know what, I need to get back to my father. And see, in Luke chapter 15, in these three parables, Jesus wants us to understand, God wants us to understand that lost souls matter. And if lost souls matter to God, lost souls must matter and should matter to God's people, the church. Why not use every effort? Let's show it that lost souls matter through our attitude and our actions to go towards those who are sinners, those who are separated from God. Let's show it through our mercy, because these parables are about the mercy of God. Let's show it through our mercy, through our compassion, through our care, our concern from those who maybe the world has rejected, the world despises, the sinners and the outcasts, those that the world looks down upon, those who have been mistreated and abused by the enemy, and the enemy is sin and Satan himself. Let's show extra effort and concern and care for these individuals. Let's do all we can, just like that shepherd that lost that one sheep, just like that woman, you know, that lost that one coin, and just like that father who couldn't wait for his son to come back home. It's all about mercy, y'all. Do you care? How much is a soul worth to you? And how much is that lost soul worth to you? If it matters to God, if lost souls matter to God, lost souls ought to matter to you, to me, and the church as a whole. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for another day that you bless us to be able to see. Kind Father, we give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise. We realize we would not be here today if it were not for your mercy and your grace, Father. You smiled upon us. You kept us from all harm, hurt, and danger, and you allowed us to open our eyes this morning to see a day we've never seen before and we will never see again. Thank you, Father. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And Father, this morning, we're so grateful that lost souls matter to you, that those people who are often despised and rejected and mistreated and abused, Father, those people are us. We matter to you, Father, and help us to see the value that other individuals have in your sight, especially those, Father, who don't know you, those who are separated from you, Father, because of sin, because of circumstances in their life. You care for them just as much as you care for your church, Father, those who are saved. And so, Father, help us to have the right attitude and the right mindset and the right level and spirit of mercy and compassion, Father, for those who are hurting, those who are in bondage to sin. Those, Father, we're not better than them, Father. You've just chosen us, Father, to be able to be your hands and your feet to go out and deliver those who are in bondage to sin, Father, through the good news of Jesus Christ. So, Father, help us. Help us to have the mind of Jesus. Help us to be welcoming to sinners and those who are outcasts. Help us to have the right spirit so we can connect with people and we can connect people with Christ, Father, so that others can see your love in us, Father, your mercy, your compassion, and that they will be drawn to us, not us, Father, but drawn to you in us, working in us and through us, Father, to draw them to you. Help us, Father, with our attitude. Help us, Father, not to have the attitude, the unrighteous, the hypocritical spirit of the scribes and the Pharisees, Father, who despised Jesus and the things that he did, Father. Help us to have the mind of Christ, the love of Christ. Because we know, Father, that's what you desire of us. And Father, as we go through this day, we pray, Father, that you will lead, guide, and direct us our steps. Please give us the strength, the wisdom, and the courage we need, Father, in order to live for your glory and your honor on this day. Father, guide us, Father. Again, we just pray that we will just have that love for others, Father, that you want us to have. And show mercy, Father, the same way you show us mercy. Help us to show that mercy towards others. Be willing to forgive, Father, and be gracious and kind, Father, to those that we come in contact with today. Because we know in doing so, Father, when we do that, that's how we let our light so shine before men, that they may see our good works and glorify you who art in heaven. But Father, please bless us to keep that in mind as we go through this day. As always, Father, we lift up those among us, Father, who are sick, those who are shut in their homes, they're bedridden, Father, whether they're in the hospital, the nursing home, or even in their own home, Father. We pray and ask in Jesus' name that you will release your healing mercy upon them. Restore them back to a normality of health and strength, whether their sickness is physical, mental, or spiritual, Father. We pray for their healing and restoration right now in Jesus' name. And Father, we continue to lift up those who are grieving. As always, Father, we know we will live in a world that's filled with trouble and hardship. There are people who are going through some really tough situation right now. And they may put on a smile on the outside, but they're really going through something right now. And those who have lost loved ones, those who have lost jobs, those whose relationships have been broken, Father, we pray that you would heal their hurting hearts right now. Comfort them, Father. Let them know that everything is going to be all right. Help them not to become discouraged, but to hold to your unchanging hand. And Father, we continue to pray for every individual that's joining me in this prayer right now. You know exactly what we need before we even ask. And so, Father, we come to you right now by faith in Jesus' name, Father, asking you to please provide for our needs, Father. Provide for us the things that we stand in need of, Father. And as you do, Father, help us to remember to say thank you, Lord. Thank you for keeping every promise that you have made to us. Thank you for providing for us. Thank you for helping us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for forgiving us. Thank you for leading us. Thank you for guiding us and blessing us, because we know we don't even deserve it. So, Father, we just thank you. We pray your blessing upon every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, every household, every family, every church that's represented in this prayer right now. Lead us, Father. We trust you. We love you. That's why we come to you right now. Father, continue to bless this nation that we live in. Because we know when things go well for our nation, and things go well for us as your children. And so, Father, we pray for our leaders. We lift them up before you, asking that you be merciful unto them, Father, and that their hearts will be in your hands. We pray for our world as well. And bless your church, Father, that we will love sinners just like you do, that we will care about them, Father, and do all we can to help the sinners to know, those who are seeking, Father, help them to know that they are welcome. They are welcome, Father. You welcome them, and so do we. Thank you for Jesus, the one who gave us these parables and set the example for us to follow, and whose death, burial, and resurrection makes this prayer even acceptable in your sight. It's in his name, in Jesus' name, we ask this prayer and we give thanks. Amen. Don't forget, lost souls matter, y'all. Let's have that sense of urgency and compassion for those who are the outcasts and the sinners of our society. Let's do all we can to let them know and experience the love of God. If Jesus welcomed sinners, we as his people, his church, we must welcome them as well. Y'all have a blessed weekend. Don't forget to join us on Sunday morning, Sunday school at 9 a.m., worship service at 10 a.m. If you can't meet us there, we hope to see you again on Monday morning for another conversation with God. Take care, everybody.
I do not own the rights to this video, but I wanted to give you a treat. It's the first time you get to see the video of the music you've been listening to and enjoying. I do not own the rights to this music or video.
Cuando tú me miras se me sube el corazón, me palpita lento el corazón. Y en un silencio tu mirada dice mil palabras. La noche en la que te suplico que no salga el sol.
Bailando.
Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed that. It's only half of the video, but it was enough. It's the same amount of time we normally play the music alone. Anyway, that was Enrique Iglesias' video, Bailando. Okay, guys, well, welcome. Bienvenido a la clase de Rayfield. Español a Rayfield. And it is Thursday, so we're going to do our lesson, which, as you know, is with a young man and a young woman out on a date. He asked her for her phone number, and let's see what happens from here as we continue. So our next episode, which is part 10, is entitled Call Me Maybe. So it's you remember that we've had several encounters between the young man and young woman. And now we're still in the part called relationships. And this call me maybe is a indication that they like each other. So who remembers what happened previously where we left off? Anybody? Who wants to go ahead and tell us what happened? Okay, keep in mind it was a few things. And they talked about their families and whatnot. So we're going to see a little bit of the last few, clips to catch up. Okay, well, young lady was telling him that she had a great time, okay? La pasé muy bien. La pasé muy bien. Okay, ladies, on three, unos, dos, tres. La pasé muy bien. La pasé muy bien. I had a great time. La pasé muy bien. And then he told her that he'd like to see her again. So, me gustaría verte de nuevo. Again is de nuevo. Me gustaría verte de nuevo. Conmigo dos veces son tres hombres. Unos, dos, tres. Me gustaría verte de nuevo. Me gustaría verte de nuevo. Bueno. So consequently, what follows is he asks her for her number. May I have your number? Okay. So, me puedes dar tu número. Me puedes dar tu número. Unos, dos, tres conmigo, caballeros. One, two, three. Me puedes dar tu número. Me puedes dar tu número. Me puedes dar tu número. Well, she's excited and happy. She says, sure. Give me your phone. How do you say sure? Por supuesto. Remember that. Por supuesto. Dame tu teléfono. Por supuesto. Dame tu teléfono. Conmigo, señoritas, son tres. Unos, dos, tres. Por supuesto. Dame tu teléfono. Por supuesto. Dame tu teléfono. There. Now I have your number too. Okay, aquí tienes. Ahora también tengo tu número. Aquí tienes. Ahora también tengo tu número. Conmigo dos veces son tres. Aquí tienes. Ahora también tengo tu número. Aquí tienes. Ahora también tengo tu número. Great. Goodbye, Emma. Estupendo. Adios, Emma. Estupendo. Great. Estupendo. Bye, Emma. Adios, Emma. Conmigo dos veces son tres, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Por estupendo. Estupendo. Adios, Emma. Estupendo. Adios, Emma. Okay. Bye, Liam. Adios, Liam. Adios, Liam. Very simple. Let's practice that together, ladies. Conmigo dos veces son tres. Unos, dos, tres, señoritas. Adios, Liam. Adios, Liam. Good guys. Two more times. Adios, Liam. Adios, Liam. I really like Emma. Me gusta mucho, Emma. Me gusta mucho, Emma. Okay, guys, conmigo dos veces en tres. Unos, dos, tres. Me gusta mucho, Emma. Me gusta mucho, Emma. I really like Emma. Me gusta mucho, Emma. All right, that's easy to remember. Me gusta. I'd like to see her again. Quiero volver a verla. Quiero volver a verla. Okay. Caballeros, conmigo, dos veces son tres. Uno, dos, tres. Quiero volver a verla. Quiero volver a verla. I'd like to see her again. Quiero volver a verla. Very good, guys. He's thinking. He's saying, should I call her now? ¿Debería llamarla ahora? ¿Debería llamarla ahora? Conmigo, dos veces son tres, caballero. ¿Debería llamarla ahora? ¿Debería llamarla ahora? Should I call her now? Don't we all think like that, huh? We're wondering what to do. What's the next move? Is it too soon? ¿Es demasiado pronto? Look at that word, demasiado. Remember that. You want to say, is it too much? Demasiado. ¿Es demasiado pronto? Is it too soon? Conmigo dos veces son tres, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. ¿Es demasiado pronto? ¿Es demasiado pronto? I don't want to wait too long. Again, there's that word. Too. Demasiado. No quiero esperar demasiado. No quiero esperar demasiado. Conmigo son tres, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. No quiero esperar demasiado. No quiero esperar demasiado. I don't want to wait too long. What to do? Wow, how cool is that? While he's thinking about if he should call her, his phone rings and he sees her. He's, wow, it's her. Es ella. Es ella. Okay, guys, conmigo dos son tres. Unos, dos, tres. Es ella. Es ella. It's her. Es ella. And with a big smile on his face, hello. Hola. Come on, guys. You know how to say hello? Conmigo dos son tres. Unos, dos, tres. Hola. Hola. Hello. Boy, is he happy. He was thinking if he should call her or not. And bam, she calls him. He got game. Well, hi, Liam. Hola, Liam. Conmigo, dos veces tres. Señoritas, unos, dos, tres. Hi, Liam. Hola, Liam. Hola, Liam. I wonder what she's got to say to him. Let's find out. Hola, Liam. They're so cute. Well, Liam tells her excitedly, Emma, I'm glad you called. Emma, me alegro de que hayas llamado. Emma, me alegro a que... ¿De qué has llamado? Conmigo les dicen tres caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Emma, me alegro de que hayas llamado. Emma, me alegro de que hayas llamado. Wow, she asks him, are you busy next Friday night? ¿Estás ocupado? ¿El próximo viernes por la noche? ¿Estás ocupado? El viernes próximo por la noche. Conmigo de seis en tres, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. ¿Estás ocupado el viernes por la noche? Well, Liam says, not at all. Por nada. Para nada. Conmigo de seis, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Para nada. Para nada, not at all. Two more times. Para nada. Para nada, not at all. He's excited. Would you like to see a movie with me? ¿Te gustaría ver una película conmigo? ¿Te gustaría ver una película conmigo? Dos, seis, en tres conmigo, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. ¿Te gustaría ver una película conmigo? ¿Te gusta ver una película conmigo? Boy, things are really going his way. I would like that very much, he says. Me gustaría mucho eso. Me gustaría mucho eso. Conmigo, dos, seis, en tres, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Me gustaría mucho eso. Me gustaría mucho eso. Gustaría is would like. Me gustaría mucho eso. I would like that very much. Wonderful, she says. Okay, chance to learn a new word. Maravilloso means wonderful, marvelous. Maravilloso. Conmigo, dos son tres, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. Maravilloso, maravilloso, marvelous. Try it again. Maravilloso, maravilloso. Well, he asked her, is this something that you'd like to see? ¿Hay algo que te gustaría ver?
hay algo, something, algo, que te gustaría ver? Conmigo dos veces en tres, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. ¿Hay algo que te gustaría ver? ¿Hay algo que te gustaría ver? Is there something you would like to see? ¿Hay algo que te gustaría ver? And she responds, nothing in particular. Nada, nothing. En particular, particular. Nada. En particular. Conmigo dos veces en tres, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. Nada en particular. Nada en particular. The word is the same, pronounced a little differently. En particular. Nada en particular. So yes, what kind of movies do you like? ¿Qué tipo de película te gusta? ¿Qué tipo de película te gusta? Conmigo dos veces en tres, caballeros. ¿Qué tipo de película te gusta? ¿Qué tipo de película te gusta? What kind of movies do you like? ¿Qué tipo de película te gusta? Well, she responds, that depends on my mood. Makes sense. Eso depende de mi estado de ánimo. Mood. Estado de ánimo. Remember, mood is estado de ánimo. Eso depende de mi estado de ánimo. Conmigo dos veces en tres, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. Eso depende de mi estado de ánimo. I always enjoy a comedy movie. Siempre, always, siempre. Disfruto, enjoy, de una película de comedia. Conmigo dos veces en tres. Unos, dos, tres. Siempre disfruto de una película de comedia. Very good. Comedy movies are great. Las películas de comedia son geniales. Conmigo dos veces en tres, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Las películas de comedia son geniales. Las películas de comedia son geniales. So, películas, movie, geniales, great. It's fun to laugh. Es divertido reír. Fun. Divertido. Divertido. Laugh, reír, reír. Es divertido reír. Conmigo dos veces en tres, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Es divertido reír. Es divertido reír. Very good. We're learning words. También me gustan las películas de acción. Action, acción. También, also. También me gustan las películas de acción. Conmigo dos veces en tres, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. También me gustan las películas de acción. También me gustan las películas de acción. Very good, guys. Películas de acción. She tells him, action movies get my heart pounding. Las películas de acción me aceleran el corazón. Conmigo dos veces en tres. Las películas de acción me aceleran el corazón. Me aceleran el corazón. Las películas de acción me aceleran el corazón. And so do horror movies. También las películas de terror. También las películas de terror. Conmigo las veces en tres, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. También las películas de horror. También las películas de terror. One more time. También las películas de terror. Do you ever watch drama movies? ¿Algún vez has visto películas dramáticas? Conmigo dos veces en tres. ¿Algún vez ¿Has visto películas dramáticas? ¿Alguna vez has visto películas dramáticas? Sometimes I do. A veces lo hago. Conmigo dos veces son tres caballeros. A veces lo hago. Sometimes I do. A veces lo hago. Sometimes. A veces. Times. A veces. A veces lo hago. Sometimes I do. A veces lo hago. Okay, catching on. Well, let's see what's showing. Veamos qué películas hay en cartelera. Veamos qué películas hay en cartelera. Conmigo les dicen tres, caballero. Uno, dos, tres. Veamos qué películas hay en cartelera. Veamos qué películas hay en cartelera. Well, there's a new romantic comedy showing. Hay una nueva de comedia romántica. Hay una nueva de comedia romántica. Okay, guys, conmigo dos veces son tres. Unos, dos, tres. Hay una nueva de comedia romántica. Hay una nueva de comedia romántica. Romántica, romantic. Una nueva, a new one. It's called Second Date. How ironic, huh? It's called Second Date. Se llama Segunda Cita. Se llama Segunda Cita. Conmigo las veces son tres, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Se llama Segunda Cita. Se llama Segunda Cita. It's called the Second Date. That's exactly what these guys are. And she says, well, that sounds perfect, okay? How do you say it sounds? Remember? Suena. Eso suena perfecto. Eso suena perfecto. Conmigo dos veces son tres. Unos, dos, tres, señoritas. Eso suena perfecto. Esa suena perfecto. That sounds perfect. Second date. And she asks, what time does it start? A qué hora? What time? A qué hora comienza? Does it start? Comienza. A qué hora comienza? Conmigo dos veces son tres, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. A qué hora comienza? A qué hora comienza? What time does it start? Comienza. Comienza. There's a showing at 7 p.m. on Friday. Hay una a las 7 p.m. del viernes. Hay una a las 7 p.m. del viernes. Conmigo les visten tres caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Hay una a las 7 p.m. del viernes. Hay una a las 7 p.m. del viernes. She says, that works for me. Esa funciona para mí. Use the word function. That works, that functions. Esa funciona para mí. Dos veces son tres, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. Esa funciona para mí. Esa funciona para mí. That works for me. Esa funciona para mí. For the logistics, do you want to meet at the theater? ¿Quieres que nos vemos en el teatro? ¿Quieres que nos veamos en el teatro? Uno, dos, tres, conmigo, señoritas. ¿Quieres que nos veamos en el teatro? ¿Quieres que nos veamos en el teatro? Yes, let's do that. He thinks it's a good idea. Sí. Hagamos eso. Sí. Hagamos eso. Conmigo dos veces son tres, caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Sí. Hagamos eso. Sí. Hagamos eso. Yep. Let's do that. Very simple. I'm looking forward to seeing you again. Estoy deseando verte de nuevo. Estoy deseando verte de nuevo. Conmigo las veces son tres caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Estoy deseando verte de nuevo. Estoy deseando verte de nuevo. I'm looking forward to seeing you again. And she's just as excited. She says, me too. See you there. Yo también. Nos vemos. Yo también. Nos vemos. Okay, ladies. Dos veces son tres conmigo. Unos, dos, tres. También. Nos vemos. También. Nos vemos. And he confirms. See you there. Nos vemos. Conmigo dos veces son tres caballeros. Unos, dos, tres. Nos vemos. Nos vemos. See you there. Nos vemos. Nos vemos. See you there. Very good. He tells her goodbye, Emma. Adios, Emma. Adios, Emma. Conmigo les besan tres, caballero. Unos, dos, tres. Adios, Emma. Adios, Emma. Two more times. Adios, Emma. Adios, Emma. Very good. This turned out to be a great phone call for him. Adios, Emma. And in turn, Emma says, goodbye, Liam. Adios, Liam. Dos veces en tres conmigo, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. Adios, Liam. Adios, Liam. Goodbye, Liam. Adios, Liam. Adios, Liam. Very good, girls. One more time. Adios, Liam. She thinks to herself, this will be fun. Eso será, will be. Será divertido. Eso será divertido. Okay, señoritas, dos veces en tres conmigo. This will be fun. Unos, dos, tres. Eso, esto será divertido. Esto será divertido. This will be fun. Well, as a girl, she can't leave it alone. She has to create a problem. Now, what should I wear? Ahora, ¿qué me pongo? Ahora, ¿qué me pongo? Señoritas, dos veces son tres conmigo. Unos, dos, tres. What should I wear? Ahora, ¿qué me pongo? Ahora, ¿qué me pongo? Me pongo. What should I wear? I could dress casually. Podría vestirme. Casualmente. Podría vestirme casualmente. Conmigo las veces son tres, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. Podría vestirme casualmente. Podría vestirme casualmente. I could dress casually. The weather is warm. El clima, weather, el clima es cálido. La clima es cálido. Dos veces en tres conmigo, señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. La clima es cálido. La clima es cálido. The climate is warm. The weather is warm. La clima es cálido. Would shorts be okay? Estarían buenos pantalones cortes. Estarían buenos pantalones cortos. Conmigo les visten tres señoritas. Unos, dos, tres. Estarían buenos pantalones cortos. Estarían buenos pantalones cortos. And then she thinks to herself, no, maybe I'll wear my new dress. No, tal vez, maybe, me ponga a ver mi nuevo vestido. Conmigo deslizan tres señoritas, unos, dos, tres. No, tal vez me pongo mi nuevo vestido. No, tal vez me pongo mi nuevo vestido.
Is it too revealing? ¿Es demasiado revelador? Conmigo deslizan tres señoritas, unos, dos, tres. Is it too revealing? ¿Es demasiado revelador? ¿Es demasiado revelador? Is it too revealing? ¿Es demasiado revelador?
What to do? What should I do? She asks herself. ¿Qué debo hacer? ¿Qué debo hacer? Conmigo deslizan tres señoritas. What should I do? Unos, dos, tres. ¿Qué debo hacer? ¿Qué debo hacer? Oh, how women drive themselves crazy trying to figure out what they need to wear. Oh, this poor girl. Okay, guys, and that's the end of this episode. Thank you for hanging out with me. This is to be continued, as you know. And hasta la vista. And hasta mañana. We'll see each other tomorrow. So, adios. We have so many different ways of saying goodbye. Adios. Hasta mañana. Ciao.